Well, my educational background, slightly unconventional. I went to university and did a chemistry degree, and it had some side modules of business. There was some general studies in there, but also some computing. When I left university, I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do, and I actually went into retail and actually worked for a big supermarket for a few years. I worked in various departments, and after that I moved to a small outdoor clothing outlet and was a shop manager there. So not really using my degree at all in any way. We acquired a number of other businesses. So I took it upon myself to join all of these different shops up and bring all their till systems together, so all the stock and sales information, so that when we were buying stock, we knew we were selling across the company and could forecast and buy accordingly. So that was really what got me started on an IT path. After that, I moved into biotechnology actually, and wrote an intranet system for a biotech startup. So again, quite different. And then from there, I moved to a digital agency. I had a number of high-profile fashion clients, and I was a senior developer in there. So running a team of about 15 web developers. And spending a lot of time with clients and working out what their requirements were. And that was, to me, one of the more interesting parts of the job, was actually working directly with the client and working out what's the very best thing we can do for these websites to really get them performing. From there, I then moved to a large UK fashion retailer. They were one of our clients in the digital agency, and they decided to bring their entire development in-house. So I already had a pre-existing relationship with the company. I then moved down to Kent from Scotland and worked with them for a couple of years and starting up a brand new digital team within the company. And a lot of my time was spent on human resource and working out what we should be doing to the website, managing infrastructure and things like that. I was always more interested moving away from the technical side of things to the business side of things. It was much more part of the decision making process. The business is where the decisions are made, and then the technical teams are just expected to implement that. So the business side is certainly a lot more interesting. So then I was offered the job at Schuh, back in Scotland as deputy head of e-commerce, which I was delighted to take. I didn't really know Schuh, but upon investigation, found out really good company. And moved fully from the technical side of things into a more general e-commerce and business role. But the technical side has always been very important in my time at Schuh, and I've been able to really help the company produce the best website you can, or certainly move towards that. As deputy head of e-commerce, I have a team of six managers reporting to myself. So there's digital marketing, there is project management, there's digital merchandising, there's online content management, and I also have an analytics manager. So they report to me, and then there's a substantial team then report to them. And I report into the head of e-commerce. So I'm responsible for the day-to-day operation of that e-commerce department, as well as looking at more strategic, longer-term plans. So, for example, currently planning the full next year's projects. And we have a timetable for those projects, and right through into Q1 of the following year. So, looking at things in a slightly longer time scale. Some of the benefits of business to consumer e-commerce for a company are substantially lower costs. you don't have to pay for physical bricks and mortar stores. You don't have to have quite as many staff as you would have for a store of equivalent turnover. It is easier to penetrate wider markets because the internet's open for everyone. Some of the challenges are that if you're selling a commodity product, for example, the shoes that we sell are sold by many different people. So you have to look at how you can differentiate your sales from your competitors. And some competitors may well be willing to sell the shoes at a much lower margin than perhaps that we would. We're a full price offering as a company. We don't look to heavily discount to compete on price. We compete on service and quality of service. So we're really focused on a high service offering. And customers love it. But you still will have very price sensitive customers who will look for the very base price they can get. So there are challenges, but good marketing can always help in situations. The elements of good online customer service would be, well, first of all, having the right product. Having complete sizes and really allowing the customer to find that product on your website as much as anything, and giving them as much detail as possible. They obviously can't touch and feel the shoe. So for example, we have implemented a 360 degree product photography, so you can see all aspects of the shoe. You've got to be able to serve the content in a way that is suitable for the customer. For example, customers are getting much more mobile. About 20% of the online business has perhaps been taken through mobile devices. So, for example, we're all familiar with tablet devices and their touch interfaces. So you should make the website accessible to those devices and be swipeable, for example. So it's considering how the customer wants to interact with you. But we also provide lots of human interaction through the website. One thing we're particularly strong at is our customer service team. We have a highly provisioned customer service team. So response times are typically far quicker than you would see throughout the industry. We provision for speed. No customer likes to phone up and be kept on hold for a long, long time. So we typically have response times to tweets within about 10 minutes, about a 4-second pickup time for calls. Emails are typically answered within 90 minutes. We also incorporate live video chat into the website. And this was a bit of a revelation for us. We saw it as another customer service tool, but it actually turned out to be a pre-sales tool. The customers wanted to find out about the shoes before they purchased them and quite liked talking to somebody about them. So innovations like that have been a real valuable part of what we do and actually are revenue generators for us. Innovation is an ever-present aspect of the digital world. Things move very quickly. And companies need to be strategic in their innovation. So what I would mean by that is that we need to put processes in place to allow you to innovate cheaply and quickly. So anything you can do to lower the barrier to innovate. For example, Tesco's are looking at what we call multi-tenanted platforms. So for all their international expansion, they would have different front ends to their website, but all sitting on the one platform. So as opposed to perhaps what's the traditional model of duplicating their websites, they would just have one website with a different fascia attached to it. So that means that all their business logic, which is quite often the difficult thing to implement, is just done once. So this allows them to roll out changes very quickly and roll out sort of expansion into new countries very, very quickly. At Schuh, we're very much looking to what someone like Tesco is doing in terms of being able to plan for innovation. You also need to be aware of what's happening in the marketplace, and also what everybody else is talking about. We're quite keen to go to conferences and hear what everyone's talking about. And again, we always do look to some of the bigger retailers. Shoes and commodity groceries perhaps don't seem that competitive or perhaps that related. But customers visit places like Tesco's, Sainsbury's, their websites a few times a week. Shoes, you may perhaps visit, you may visit our website once every 3 to 6 months, unless you're a fanatical shoe shopper. So customers are having their expectations set by using someone like Tesco's or Sainsbury's. So I think anyone trading digitally has to look to the big players where customers are spending their time for some steer. Security is a major challenge in e-commerce. There have been many publicly visible breaches in security where there have been payment problems. So it is paramount. There are the credit card industry, the payment card industry, as they like to be known, have a set of standards for security. So it is the payment card industry's data security standard, which controls a lot of what major retailers do online in terms of how they interact with credit cards as a payment security. You also have to look at data protection issues and anytime you're storing customers' data. And also there are aspects of trust in there. So if you're sending out email newsletters, for example, then I would think that would come into a general security thought in terms of data protection. Are you overly using your customers' data? And I'd always advocate retaining data only as long as you would need it. Some of the benefits of business-to-business commerce are very much similar to business-to-consumers, lower barriers. There's no, very few companies now produce catalogues or certainly reduced output in catalogues. It's all digital catalogues. It means everything is much more up to date. You have opportunities for your client businesses to order direct from your business to business website, so you can reduce order processing costs. Live inventory, so that your client businesses know what you have in stock. Often, if you look at in terms of wholesalers to retailers, for example, your retailers, if it's a small company, will be looking to order at all times of day and night. If it's an entrepreneur who's got a startup shop, for example, they're going to be pretty busy in their shop and they'll want to be able to order stock out with shop hours. So there is a lot of benefits to the sort of immediacy of information, but also the richness of content. So if a supplier has their own digital content on their website, they can often supply that to their client businesses for use on their websites. Some of the other benefits, I guess, would be speed of logistics. So as part of the digital ordering process, often these orders can be turned around a lot quicker. And some of the challenges of business to business, I guess many of the supplier businesses sometimes feel threatened by the client businesses, where lots of the supplier businesses perhaps have their own digital e-commerce offering, And as the supplier businesses, as the client businesses become more savvy, they are then competing with the business that is selling the products. Businesses have changed in their approach to information systems over the past decade. For what was perhaps initially e-commerce was maybe just sent off to the IT department to do something with it, it is now fully provisioned. Given the size of the team I earlier described, at Schuh, we plan for the success of our e-commerce website. In the UK market, which is the highest penetration of e-commerce in the world, on average 20% of business is done online. Now that is across all sectors. So in electricals, typically that's a lot higher, down to the food and commodity grocery, which is a lot lower level, but on average 20%. Representing a multi-billion dollar industry. So boardrooms are pretty serious about it now. And you know, many of the big players have gone through many iterations of websites and through from something fairly basic to something that's now driven at board level. Most companies will have an e-commerce director, which is would have been unusual 10 years ago. I think in the future, more and more of that market share will be moving online. But things, it's not to say that bricks and mortar retail is dead by any means. Customers still like to feel and see a product. I think where we're moving to though is what's known as multi-channel retail, where customers are typically taking longer than they have ever taken to make a purchase decision, touching on many different aspects of your offering. So, for example, looking at your website for research. So what is known as a research online, buy offline model. But they also talk to friends, they'll have social interactions on the social networks. They'll look at reviews, and this is only going to get richer and more seamless. Shops will start offering, you'll be able to see reviews in store. So, but then there'll be more from the offline experience coming online in terms of better interactions with the product, augmented reality, and then these more natural technologies. When I say natural, I mean that it's how we as humans perhaps interact with product and with other people. We typically don't wander around pressing keys in our head. So we touch products. So things like augmented reality, where you can really see what the product looks like, is going to be much more. The advice I'd give to anyone looking to work in the IT IS sector is, it's a great job, but bring that business side with you to any IT jobs. Always remember what you're trying to get out of the end of the day. IT is an enabling service, if you like. It is not an end in itself. If we look at e-commerce, we're there to sell products to customers. So never forget there is a real product and there's a real person at the end of that website. Don't think of people as traffic or as consumers, they are people. There are real interactions in there. And get to know who your customers are. So if you're going to work in e-commerce, one of the most valuable things I've done since I started at Schuh was I spent time in the shops. With my retail background, I feel that I know how to interact with customers. I know what customers like, so never forget that. Feel your product, know what the product's like, spend some time in the distribution centre for sending out products. It's one of the most interesting things you can do is watch that product that's been purchased, get packaged up and sent out the building. It's a real thing. It's not an abstract, purely digital experience. The digital is just an enabling.